So, I have the honor to introduce Dr. Alan Andrews, who at least some of us met in at the Otolith Symposium in Mallorca about 1 year ago. And Alan, he has worked at Moss Landings in California, and you have got your PhD in South Africa, and today you are working for NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in Hawaii.
Yes.
And Alan has specialized in aging of fish and validation of ages found. And today he will speak on bombs and fish, how nuclear bombs can tell us about the ages of fishes. So Alan, welcome to Sweden and to SL Rakpa.
Thank you very much.
The floor is yours.
The floor is mine. Okay.
And if I missed something important, please add
okay.
that.
Okay, I'll fill in.
Fill in.
All right, hello everyone. And hello everyone. Can everybody see me? just to start with, I kind of like to give my seminars as sort of an open thing where if you have any questions as I'm talking, just raise your hand. I'm totally open to slowing down. You know, I understand, you know, everybody speaks English, but if I go too fast or skip over something that you don't understand, just please ask me. I can elaborate a little more on it. I just happened to be traveling in Europe last week. I was in Sicily. I'm collaborating with some colleagues at the fisheries group in Italy, working on European hake. I'm actually going to touch on that right at the end. Week before that, I was in Zurich working at ETH University on some innovative stuff where they're more on the technical side of things, and I'll show you some of the application-oriented stuff that's really exciting and pioneering. But basically, I just want to kind of give you guys a rundown on some of the stuff I've been doing kind of for fun. But this is kind of a good synopsis, a little bit about sharks. I'm actually working with turtles a little bit. Reef fishes, this is the pink Hawaiian snapper. That's the one that the species they actually got me out to Hawaii. And then, of course, nuclear bombs. This is Castle Romeo, one of the largest nuclear events, 11 megatons. And I'll show you how this kind of plays into how we can use these kind of crazy events as something that is a tool in validating the fish. So this is where I work. This is not where we are now. It's much warmer there than this place, although this is probably a nice weather for you guys. Basically, normally I have a pointer, but you guys can't see it. So I started my work in California. I've been working with deep water rockfishes. I've worked with my PhD with Disaustagus species off of Antarctica and off of Chile. Working on the Great Barrier Reef, done some age validation with reef fishes there. I'll touch on that a little bit. But in Hawaii, what got me out there was is that basically I'm here in Oahu, and we're in charge of this whole area of the Hawaiian archipelago. There's a whole group of fishes there that are managed collectively. And so this is the Hawaiian group. I just sort of grabbed this the other day as an example. But basically the whole Northwest Hawaiian Islands and the main Hawaiian Islands is where I'm working primarily, but I'm also doing work in other places. So we're going to shift to another place. I'm going to give kind of a synopsis of work that I presented at the Sharks International Symposium in Durban, South Africa last year. Went to the Radiocarbon in the Environment meeting last year, and that's what got me out to ETH in Zurich. And then, of course, the Otolith Symposium this last year as well. So with fish, I think most of you know, scales, vertebrae, fin rays are some of the other choices, but primarily it's been with otoliths. Basically sectioning them has led to much greater estimates of age. This is the short-raker rockfish estimated to be more than 100 years old. And I think most of you are familiar with sectioning, revealing lots and lots of growth zones. The question is, are these actually annual? The lower image is the full cross-section. This small square is zoomed in on. You can start to see stuff that looks more like a redwood tree. Lots of growth zones there. And the question is, are they annual? And it turns out that they are. There's a technique that I used for my master's thesis called lead radium dating. I'm not going to go into that here, but basically we validated that these fish do get to be over 100 years old. So with fish, you know, there's the von Verlamping growth function, validating how fish grow. The K value is very important. And of course, ultimately, we really want to know about longevity. And typically, that's been underestimated in most cases. So this is the species that got me out to Hawaii. We're dealing with a data-poor fishery. It's not sampled on a regular basis. It's actually tough to get samples. I was really lucky to have some archival samples, and I'll show you how that played out. But the opakapaka, the pink Hawaiian snapper, is the one that got me out to Hawaii. Working on onaga and some of the other species. There's the hapu that was in the other figure. So I'm working on this complex, and the tricky part is that this fishery is managed as a complex. They're brought in all at once. But the life histories are very likely different, especially for the grouper. So here's what I had to start with. These are the various and sundry growth curves for the species estimated in different ways. Listed below, you see dailies, link frequency analyses, oxytetracycline and tag recapture studies have all produced very different growth curves. K values of 0.15 up to 0.5. So really, really different characteristics. Not a great scenario when it comes to trying to manage the fishery and understanding its growth. So the more reliable studies predicted maybe out to about 18 years was the maximum age. But truthfully, none of the largest fish had ever been aged. This was all based on early growth extrapolation into the largest sizes. So in comes this interesting testing. It was first done by John Kalish in 1993, the use of atmospheric testing in the 1950s and 60s, thermonuclear testing by the U.S. and Russia and other countries. Basically, when we got into the megatons of TNT, these explosions went through the troposphere into the stratosphere and created a global radiocarbon signal that effectively doubled the naturally occurring levels. Sounds like a lot. It's very low, actually, but we actually doubled those levels. And here's what this looks like. So this is a two-axis curve. The first one is on the left-hand side is delta C14. So delta is change from a value. This is not zero. It's actually zero as in no change from the pre-bomb levels. You can see that we go all the way up to about 1,000 per mil, which is basically a doubling of the original levels. The other axis is these are binned nuclear events where the cumulative megatons of TNT are stacked up. And you can see the close correlation with the atmosphere. This, of course, worked its way into the marine environments through natural air-sea diffusion. And you can see from this nice example that Alan Druppel put together in 2002 that the rise is effectively pretty close to the late 50s. But the way it rises is very different as you go through time. French Frigate Shoals is the very top one. That's actually in the middle of the Northwest Hawaiian Islands. Very rapid, quick response. But as you go further down into areas where you start to have upwelling and other influences, the signal starts to get attenuated and it's a little more slow. It might not be as good for any kind of temporal reference. So when it comes to utilizing this record as a tool, you really need to know what's going on with radiocarbon in the area for the species of interest. So here's what I had to deal with Hawaii. So basically, hermatypic corals are a record of marine chemistry. So the carbonate that's stored there is a representation of what the radiocarbon levels were at the time. You see pre-bomb is a little bit lower than zero because there's a reservoir effect. But basically across the Hawaiian Islands, you can see that there's a nice sharp rise in the late 50s going into the early 60s. And then it peaks out and then starts to decline. So this can be compared directly to otoliths. Otoliths are also DIC, dissolved inorganic carbon. This otolith picture shows the core sort of exposed. I've actually ground down off the surface because I want to get at birth year material. So I want to sample just this material right in the middle. So basically to get a radiocarbon signal when the fish was alive. So micromilling machine is used. Tap out this little tiny pile of powder. Typically it's around 3 milligrams worth of material. It's much less than years worth of growth. And then the analysis is actually done at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, about $300 each. And that's a bargain for us because it's normally about $600 if you're non-federal. So again, here's the reference curve, sort of a little more of a generic representation with a decline that's represented by other records from dissolved inorganic carbon. And so each one of these X's is an individual fish. So each one of these measurements is an individual fish on the collection date. So that value correlates with the value of what was extracted in the middle. So for this fish, that's the collection date. This value doesn't actually belong here. What you have to do is you just extend it back to the reference curve, and that's the age of that fish at that length. So it's kind of nice. You can see with this particular selection, these are fish from the 70s and 80s. We could actually validate the age of younger fish relative to this 50s to 60s signal. So going back to the von Bernalanki growth function, we can eliminate these fast growth scenarios. The information that we felt was still robust was daily increment methods, also daily increment integration. And then beyond that, we filled it in with radiocarbon. So they get out to be out over 40 years old. So this was a big surprise, unfortunately, for the stock assessment people when we told them that they're more than 40 years old as opposed to less than 20 years old. Things had to change a lot. So this is actually a published paper. I can give you copies. Actually, I have some of my business cards over here. If you want to contact me about any of these papers, I can send them to you. But the interesting thing about this paper also is that it's independent of growth zone counting. We really didn't have any kind of reliable growth zone counting. It was all just, we went in and said, okay, here's a heavy otolith, here's a slightly lighter otolith, and we kept doing successive sample sets in order to validate age, the length of age over time. Any questions so far? Am I going too fast?
Nope.
Okay. So now, stepping to another part of the planet, Gulf of Mexico, a deep water grouper called the speckled hind. It's been aged for several decades using a particular protocol. And you can see on the right side of the otolith, there's some really well defined growth zones. This pattern's been used for several decades to assess this species. Very easy to count. I can get 23 to 25 bands repeatedly, so it's got relatively high precision. But is it accurate? This notch in the top there is actually my radiocarbon measurement. And it turns out it didn't make any sense relative to the radiocarbon record. Greater than 45 years old. So it's a problem. My first thought was, okay, we need to look at the banding pattern. I like to use transmitted light. I like light coming through that crystalline matrix to show the banding pattern, I think, better. You can still see the banding pattern that's been used for many years on the right, but on the left, I can see something there that looks a lot more like the rockfish otoliths that I'm familiar with. So if you zoom in on the left, you can see a banding pattern there, and I can count out to about 50 years fairly regularly with that banding pattern. So, unfortunately, I'm the bearer of bad news in many cases. So even experienced otolith age readers need validation, right? This has been decades worth of assessments that have been based on this 20 to maybe 30 year scenario for the species. Turns out that the species can live to be a lot older than that. And here's a little bit of a synopsis on the values. So this is the Gulf of Mexico coral reference. Okay, this is a whole suite of coral references. You see the rise in radiocarbon, peak, and then a decline. The nice thing about this record is the decline actually has a slope. So it's not quite as good in terms of temporal specificity, but you can start to age fish that are younger. So we ended up with some young fish, came all the way down the slope, and then we had this big cluster of fish that were pre-bone. We weren't expecting that. When I selected these samples, I was going with a 20 to 30 year perspective, and so I thought that they would fall somewhere on the slope, but they're basically clustered down there. Now, if I use just as a rough proxy for age otolith weight, you know, because these otoliths actually got quite a bit heavier, it looks like they would go, let's see, go one more. You can extend them way out in time. So lifespan may be on the order of 60 to 80 years for this species. So turns out that they can live to be more than 45 years old. So basically, the concluding remarks are, more than 45 years old, at least 10 to 20 years older than they originally thought, and maybe the lifespan is up to 60 or 80 years, or at least it used to be. You know, it's been a heavily fished species for many years, so those long-lived fish are probably few and far between. So this is, it exemplifies the new approach. This paper is actually, it's also been published in the Canadian Journal, so if you'd like a copy of that, I can send. So now shifting to some methodological refinements, I've been working on otoliths of the blue spine unicorn fish, the humphead wrasse, and the bumphead parrotfish. All of these fish have very small otoliths. The largest fish in each of these species was on the order of 100 to 150 milligrams for its whole otolith weight. So when I start dealing with trying to extract the core material, it's going to get pretty tricky. So I'm going to use the bumphead parrotfish from the Great Barrier Reef as an example of how this worked out pretty well. Original estimates were on the order of 40 years for this species. It was nice to have a succession of otoliths. So in the B caption, or the B part of this figure, you can see you got a juvenile otolith that's known to be less than 6 months old, a little bit older and a little bit older. And then in the A part, you can see that a cross-section of one of the oldest otoliths. This is a fish that was about 40 years old. Nice banding pattern. But when it comes to validating this, I need to know, where do I need to sample? I need to do this very carefully because I'm going to be sampling probably on the order of a milligram worth of material. But you can see that it's pretty much sitting right on top, so I can pretty much go straight in, unlike the opaca-paca where I had to kind of grind off some external layers in order to get to the core. So here's the succession. You can see A, that's the mounted otolith, B with a little pile of powder, and then C, the extracted core with the micromillimeter machine. This is a 300 micron tip. So a very small amount of material, about 0.8 to 1 milligram of carbonate is what we're getting. So the other part of this is, what's the reference record? These fish were collected all up and down the coral reef, the Great Barrier Reef. Problem is that the references are at the very southern end, so is it the same? This is where you really have to start thinking about oceanography and where the sources of radiocarbon are for the mixed layer. And it turns out that the South Equatorial Current Complex basically bathes the Great Barrier Reef with the same signal. I had one coral and algae from near Lizard Island where it happened to fall right in line from 1973. That was the only verification I really had. But I think it's safe to say that fish up and down the Great Barrier Reef are going to have a similar signal to the three coral records that are at the southern end. Here's what this looks like. So here's the composite record of all the coral reefs that are coral cores at the end of the Great Barrier Reef. The X's are the collection dates, which were very lucky to have just these three fish. They were very rare to have otoliths from the species. And the square is actually the projection of the age back to the estimated birth year. So we've got validated growth zone counting. One of them seems pretty much on. These maybe are underestimated, or maybe the coral record, or maybe the regional record is a little bit more variable than we're thinking. The other two are not quite as diagnostic up at the peak, but at least they're consistent with it. So this was also, this came out just earlier this year. I can send you a copy if you're interested in that. So now shifting gears entirely to sharks. We've done a couple of studies where the New Zealand porbeagle shark showed that vertebrae stopped growing. And so we started to investigate this with these other species. I'm going to concentrate just on the sand tiger shark, which is in the lower left. But with large shark species, basically there's a problem with understanding life history. Late maturity, low fecundity, and short lifespan. It's like, wait a minute, short lifespan? Why would they mature as a teenager and then only get to be 25 years old? Doesn't seem right, especially with the sand tiger shark, which is adelphophagous. They only have one or two pups every year, or maybe every 3 years. So why would they only have 10 years of reproductive potential? So it's very unintuitive that reproductive potential is so low. So underestimated lifespan is very likely the problem. So how we age sharks is with cross-sectioning the vertebrae. On the left is are two vertebrae together. The section on the right is just the upper half of a butterfly-type shape. It's called the corpus calcareum. You can see there's some nice banding patterns there that are fairly well-defined for the younger sharks. But bomb radiocarbon can be tricky. So with the otoliths, you're dealing with DIC. It's basically coming over the gills. You have a nice direct representation of what's in the water column, directly comparable to the coral records. But with with sharks, you're dealing with carbon sources that are dietary. So depending on what the shark has been eating, make sure you're awake, right? Depending on what the shark has been eating, that's going to be the radiocarbon signal, right? So it's going to be kind of tricky. So with the sand tiger shark, you can see the original section from the younger fish in the upper right, or upper left, and then an adult on the right there. You can count a lot of bands. You can get two really good shark agers in the room, and they'll come up with completely different numbers. The interpretation is kind of across the board. And where do you stop counting? It's fairly easy early on, but then you can be a lumper or a splitter out there towards the end. But the nice thing about these sharks is that at least we have a full carbon record across the life of the fish, or at least that's the thought, is that from birth to capture, you have a continuous radiocarbon record. So if the shark lived through the radiocarbon signal, it should show pre-bom to rise to maybe decline. That's the idea. So there's one example that shows how depleted radiocarbon can affect the signal. So you see we've got the coral in Bermuda, or the coral from Bermuda and Florida, but then you see the poor beagle shark. These are young sharks of relatively known age. So they were like 1, 2, and 4, and 7-year-old sharks. So the band counting was easy to do for the young sharks, and it's also validated in other ways. So this offset is real. It shows an attenuated signal, but also a slight phase lag. So this is the scenario we thought either the sand tiger is going to be more in line with the coral record, or maybe it'll be a little bit depleted. We happen to have a whole series of sharks that were 2 to about 10 or 12 years old for sand tigers. So all 5 of these sharks happened to be right on the rise. And it shows that this shark is much more in tune with the radiocarbon signal for the mixed layer. And this makes sense for the species because the species stays on the shelf. It doesn't go deep. It goes over deep water, but it doesn't go into deep water. So it makes sense that it's feeding on dietary sources that are in sync with the mixed layer. So you can see there's maybe a slight phase lag, which would make sense as the shark eats older things, but it's not deeply depressed like with a poor beagle. Poor beagle are known to go deep. They feed deep, so they're going to get a deep radiocarbon signal. So we felt this is our reference. So adults that lived through this period should be in line with this. This is what we got. Very deep offset. Way, way offset. And you might think, okay, well, they're feeding out, they're getting some kind of crazy radiocarbon source that's depleted. This is the edge material from the vertebrae. So you would think that that's captured date material. You can't move that number, but you can, because basically the idea is that the vertebrae stop growing. There's missing time in that record. There's no reason that the vertebrae should continue to grow. Oblates, you know, for some reason they just keep growing and growing and growing, no matter what. But with the vertebrae, it turns out that they can stop growing. So there's basically missing time. We have other information that validates up to about 10 or 12 years, but once you get beyond that, growth band counting is really questionable. Either it's slow or slow to no growth. Maybe the bands are actually there in that upper corner, but they're being scrubbed off in the cleaning process, or they're not real well calcified. There's some further investigation going there. So the conclusions were that the potential longevity exceeds 30 years for this species. We had 2 sharks from South Africa that were more than 40 years. So lifetime productivity is greater by more than 10 years. So this points to the idea, the concerns about that short, mature lifespan were correct. So sustainability of any kind of fishery associated with this kind of species is probably going to be like a slot type fishery, like with sturgeon, where you let the small ones go and maybe keep the large ones, but then the ones in the middle that you can take. So this paper came out just the latter part of last year, I think it was. Any questions so far?
Well, you said that they gave birth to new ones every third year or something like that.
Yeah, every 1 to 3 years.
Is that still valid? Is that still valid after your corrections here?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So yeah, the fecundity is low. There seems to be regional differences for this species, which is fairly cosmopolitan through the tropics, subtropics. There's some areas where they seem to have maybe every third year is a birth year, but some years or some places where they seem to have pups every year.
How long does it take for the radiocarbon to get from the atmosphere into the water and be showing up in these figures?
So the atmospheric, the phase lag from the atmosphere is about 10 years. So it starts off, it starts off relatively close, but in terms of the peak offset, so if you go from the peak of the atmosphere to the peak in most mixed layer environments, it's about a 10-year offset. And it's deeply attenuated. It's only atmospherically, it's about 1,000 per mil, about the highest values you're going to get in mixed tropic is about 200. So there's some offsets there. Is that good?
Yeah, I was wondering if it could be like affected by winds as well, though, in the atmosphere.
Like affecting the air-sea diffusion rates?
Yeah,
there's all kinds of, I mean, you're basically, this has been used as a tracer for CO2 diffusing into the mixed layer.
Oh.
So it's been a really important part of modeling.
So I was thinking if you're going to do some habitat management and you find the results in one area, you try and recreate them in another reef which is 1,000 kilometers away. Perhaps your findings from one area might be dependent on weather conditions, could be extremely different because the rate which it's got into the carbon getting into the water could be affected.
Yeah.
And then maybe
it's
not,
going to be more of
not
a much broader region. The differences are actually different over much greater scales, because the rise period is about a 10 to 12 year period. So all of the randomness that you see in the atmospheric signal sort of gets muted by the air-sea diffusion over a period of years. There's little hot spots here and there, like central gyre waters tend to have more elevated levels because their residence time is longer, so they're in contact with that 1,000 per mil signal. Then you start to get into areas where you've got upwelling going on and the signal's just crazy. So it does vary a lot, especially like along the California coast. It signals there, but then after once you get into the rise, it just does this kind of thing afterwards. So that it loses its temporal specificity. So other stuff that I've been doing is I'm working on sea turtles. The hawksbill sea turtle, which basically, its nice thick shell kind of planned its own demise because people make clips and hair things out of them. This is actually a section of the shell right here. It's called tortoise shell. So what I've done is we've gone in and done a series of samples from the most recent to the oldest material, and we're also finding that the signal is there. But it's like the radiocarbon signal with the shark vertebrae. It's dietary, and so there's some complications there. Other work I've done was on white abalone. We validated that they get to be about 30 years old, and this has led to a study that I'm doing on pearl oyster from Pearl and Hermes Atoll, which is in the Hawaiian Islands. This is the collaboration I'm doing with ETH and the Ion Beam Physics Lab, where we've got these nice pieces of carbonate. We sort of know the time span, and what we're experimenting with is laser ablation AMS, which is brand new. And since I was just there, I thought I would share a little bit about it. This is the mini carbon dating system. If any of you are familiar with the original, AMS, it's actually on the other side of that wall. It takes up a whole warehouse. There's a big, huge accelerator. This actually is small compared to the original AMS system. So over here, this is the laser ablation system. It's basically feeding CO2 directly into the ion source. It's being accelerated again. We've got counters over here and then additional counters down here. So it's very new to be feeding gas into an AMS. So So what we've done also is with red snapper oboliths, these things are huge. They're about 4 or 5 grams, huge, huge oboliths. And so we got a lot of material there. Happen to have a few specimens from the Gulf of Mexico that cover about 50 years of growth. Based on the collection date, they should have a little bit of pre-bomb. So pre-bomb should be up in this area here, and then getting into the rise, and then post-peak decline. And so just last week, we were running this system, so the obelisk is actually in here. There's a little motor that's a step motor that's moving the sample around underneath the laser. It's a 193 nanometer UV laser. And these are the track lines. So these little arrows are just so that we can see where the track lines are that we want to do, because you're looking through a little tiny slot. This is just very much a raw work in progress. But these are the track lines that we've done. This is one linear type of sampling, and then this was a zigzag pattern that we did from the core outwards. And what we did see the rise in the radiocarbon relative to the bomb period. So that's very exciting. So, and then the week after, so I was in Sicily just this last week, working with colleagues in Italy on the European hake, which is a real hot topic because the obelisks are horrible. If you've ever seen a section on them, I mean, you can count them 100 different ways. And so the tricky part is that it's looking for a reference curve. Basically, the closest one to the Mediterranean is Bermuda, but there's been a recent one in the Ligurian Sea, and that's a very fortuitous lineup for us being able to do something on the Mediterranean population of the European hake. So here's the Ligurian Sea record. It's not very high resolution, but it gives us a reference point. We had 3 large fish. Here's the values that we had for the collection years, and it was actually rare to have a sample that could line up with the rise. So basically, if we project these back, we get a series of ages. And it turns out 22 to 25 years is a valid longevity for this species. So the question was, the extremes of the age interpretation scenario. One scenario says that maybe they got to be 15 years. The other scenario was maybe to about 30 years. Turns out that the latter scenario is more accurate. So thank you very much. Any questions from the West Coast? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
One question. You hear me?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Has anyone done this on American lobster?
No. There's no real conserved structure that I think can be used that would go back long enough to be able to create some kind of temporal specificity.
Okay.
Did I talk too fast? This makes sense. Cover too much territory. I'm always afraid that I'm saying too much. But I've done a lot of work in a lot of different places, and I like sharing things like this because, you know, the reason I'm doing the work with the European hake is because I gave a presentation and I started talking with people that didn't know. And so it's always fun to do things like this to open new doorways to what else can be done. I know, you know, where I am right now is with the freshwater system. Bomb radiocarbon dating does work in the freshwater system. It's a little more complicated because it's basin specific. The freshwater signal is way more atmospheric, so the signal is very steep and strong. Being able to reference it to the otolith system is pretty tough because how do you get your reference to the lake system that you're dealing with? Steve Campana has done some work with lake trout and basically validated that they get to be over 70 years old. So freshwater systems, it does work, but it's tricky.
But Ellen, if you don't know anything from the beginning, I guess that we then should have access. We should start with otoliths, pre-bomb otoliths.
For freshwater?
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be nice to have, if you have some kind of reference.
Like you said, I mean, they were born before the bombs.
Yeah.
The tests.
Yeah. And that's where the this laser ablation work that I'm doing with ETH is so interesting is that if we can actually run a scan, get a continuous scan on an otolith, kind of like with the shark vertebrae, a complete record, the otolith is kind of tricky because the increment width changes. But now we can, you know, we can start to investigate situations where maybe we don't have any kind of regional reference. Look for that change in the signal and realize that in the marine environment, the rise time is fairly unique. It's about 1955 to 1958, pretty much across the board, except for at the poles. So and even in freshwater systems, well, you know, where's the pre-bomb level? When does it rise? When does it drop? So the laser ablation stuff is actually really exciting.
And Alan, during lunch, you asked me about this famous eel in the well.
Yeah, the eel.
Southern Sweden.
You gotta find the otoliths, right?
And I told you that otoliths, they have gone. Or we haven't found them yet. But what about the vertebra?
Mm.
They are, okay, they are, the eel is very rotten, but there are of course, some vertebra left.
You'd have to investigate it. My first thought is that you're dealing with cancellous bone, so you start to have resorption and even calcification that happens later in life in other parts of the vertebrae. That was one of the big concerns we had with shark vertebrae was, well, are we looking at stuff that's really temporally specific? And when we first started doing the work, we thought that maybe there was secondary calcification going on in some cases. But if you deal with just with the sharks, typically what we try and do is go with just the organic component, the collagen part. So you try and get rid of the inorganic stuff that maybe is solidified at different points in time. Go with the collagen, which is maybe a more conserved structure, and that seems to be a little more in sync with what we're seeing. But we definitely want to do more work with that. Again, the laser ablation stuff would be great to be able to burn lines right across these vertebrae. But the vertebrae, I think on some fish maybe it would work, but you'd have to do some truthing with some specimens that are of known age.
But beware, for freshwater, the link between water and atmosphere is very close.
Yeah.
For a well.
So the well, and we were talking about this, because if you have a well where you're drawing water from it all the time, you're going to create 20,000-year-old signal.
Yeah.
So the fish would be very, very old in that regard. Oldest fish known.
But I get this right. Most of the cases we presented here, the fish are much older than previously thought.
Yeah, and just about every case, I'm the bearer of bad news for the fishery relative to fishing down age structure. There's been arguments that, well, it's all about biomass. It's like, well, not necessarily so. Like orange ruffy, that fishery lasted 10 years in New Zealand, and it's basically because they're over 100 years old. You cut down the old growth forest, and it's not going to come back within our lifetime. There are estimates with that fishery that if they had just discovered that fishery today and tried to fish it sustainably, they would only be able to take 2% of the original standing stock biomass annually. 2%. And that'd be pushing it long term. that was another species. So the lead radium dating is the other one I use, which is a geochemical method. Basically, it's the disequilibrium of radium-226 to lead-210. And that's like an independent chronometer. It doesn't even have anything to do with the bomb signal. So we found several of the orange ruffy groups were in equilibrium, which means that they're 100, 120 years old. So we sort of put the lid on the whole idea that they are 20 to 30 year old longevity. But the other side of this too is I have papers just coming out on the Pacific cod. There were two scenarios for age. One is about a 10 or 12 year longevity. The other is a 30 year longevity. Lead radium dating proved the younger age scenario in this case. So there's one example that I have where we've shown that the younger age scenario is actually a good thing.
Now, it will be nice to see if that is a common pattern, or if you only have been looking at very long-lived species this far. I mean, what you what your thought about that? Will the
in general? I mean, because if you start going, you know, deep water, there tends to be a connection with, you know, longer lived species being in deep water, long, slow, sustainable habitat, low predation, low oxygen. But then you start getting into the reef fishes, like with the bumphead parrotfish. That 40-year-old fish wasn't even, it was maybe 3/4 or 2/3 the maximum size. So the fish that were long gone, how old were they?
Oh, yes.
So you have these dominant reef species, groupers, like the groupers, just once they set up a residence, they're highly residential, and that's all they do. They sit around and get old until a shark or a human takes them out.
Okay, yeah.
Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Any questions from the West Coast? You guys are the marine people, right?
Yes.
Do you guys age hake odolites?
I was thinking about hake, actually. It was really interesting that you are collaborating with Italy. We have a stock back here in the latest years. There was lots of hake before in the Capricat Scotland. And now it's back, apparently. But we don't age because it doesn't. We don't get that much, and it's not in our data collection framework. But so we are trying to have a bilateral agreement with some countries, Italy among which, for letting them reading it. But it would be interesting to put that in the analysis as well, and see if there's another stock or. Stock for sure. I mean, it's another.
I think I saw your Did you give a presentation at the Odalith Symposium?
No, but not on hake.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, there's other species in this region that have really noisy odaliths. The age reading scenarios just cover, you know, a factor of 2 or 3. Depending on the age reader, and so these techniques can be used to tease that out. Like even the lead radium dating that I was telling you about that I didn't cover here, but with the Pacific cod, it's actually a big deal because, you know, the difference of factor of 3 or 2 or 3 in terms of longevity is a big factor when it comes to the stock assessment.
Yeah, we have huge problems with Baltic cod.
Baltic cod. Okay.
Yeah. That's a common problem of all countries. We cannot age it, so we are actually almost giving up on the assessment based on age.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me know if you want to run some odoliths.
Yeah, exactly. That would be a good solution, actually.
Okay.
We can. Thank you very much.
All right, yeah, thank you.
Do I understand you correctly that you're only looking at C14?
Yeah, in
not
most cases it's...
Have been.
Sorry?
Not all bonds have been.
No. So so we're not tracing C14 in any one event. It's basically the whole collection of those events that created the atmospheric signal. That's pretty good mixing layer for it. So basically those multiple signals got mixed in the atmosphere. Then it gets mixed again by diffusing into the sea. So that's where we get that sort of slow, easy decline that has a lot of temporal specificity.
But there are no other elements that can be used.
Yeah.
A different mixing rate or a different trophic interaction or whatever.
The other, you could do a presence absence of something like strontium 90,
right.
Calcium analog.
Yeah.
So, but the problem with strontium 90 is that it's in fallout and it has a residence time in the stratosphere of about 2 years, falls out in rain. So when you start to look at the marine record, it's like there's nothing because it didn't exist before that. And then strontium 90 starts to show up, and it's like this, depending on where you are. So it's basically, in sediment studies, it's most successful because you can just go back in time. And once you reach that line where there's no strontium 90, then you know that that's pre-55, 54. So, but it's really when we got into the thermonuclear devices that were megatons of T TNT, and this is, it's really difficult to visualize. I've actually got into this because I have a coral core from Guam. Guam is about 2,000 kilometers from Bikini and Onewetok. And other records from the area have shown little blips that are out of sync with air-sea diffusion. Guam, I've got three huge signals that are from fallout. So I've got the nice usual incline, but then there's this major spike from the Castle series in 1954. And then in 1956, there's Red Wing, got a little blip from that. And then in 1958, there's Hardtack 1, got a little blip from that. So now I'm getting all into this oceanography thing of how the fallout signal was generated, how it was advected, doing a little bit of modeling and so on to see how the signal made its way around. But once it gets beyond that, it's so mixed that it's just basically an atmospheric diffusion model. So I have a coral core from Kure Atoll, which where we have nice high resolution record, and none of the fallout signals show up there. But yeah, Astronomy 90 is another one. So if you could do a scan across nodal, you could come up with a line, but that's a tough one to detect, especially now because we're about two to three half-lives into it being gone. It's got a half-life of about 32 years.
Yeah, I have another one. You probably know about the Chernobyl accident, and there were a lot of radioactive cesium coming out. Quite high concentrations or levels in certain parts of Sweden.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that could be used validating some ages in at least in the most heavily affected lakes?
Yeah, where you have some kind of tributary or basin that received high fallout.
Yeah,
that signal could be. It would almost certainly be in the sediments in your lake environments. And so, I mean, that would be the tracer, really, is if you had a lake system, look at the sediments, see if there's a strong 1986, was it?
Yes.
If there's a strong 86 signal, then you would think, okay, it's going to be in the fish ear bone, too. But the tricky part is I'm not sure if you could detect those low levels in the amount of material to detect it. That would be the tricky part, is having enough material. It's not like we can run, like laser ablation. You know, ICP-MS, LA ICP-MS can be used for lots of elements, but you have to have a pretty strong signal. This is like little signal, and you've got to be able to separate the isotope.
At least you know that the levels of cesium-137 was quite high in some fish species, for example, in eel, many years after the otoline.
Yeah. So you may be able to trace it in the otoliths.
Yeah.
You could even do a very primitive form of marking is basically just sectioning it flat and putting it on photographic paper. See where the ring shows up. that's the way they were doing some of the fallout particle research. They were trying to figure out vaporized reef material from these multi-megaton events. It typically went to calcium oxide, which was then rehydrated and eventually turned into calcium carbonate. And so they had these really complex structures that were in the fallout. They were trying to figure out where the radioactivity was. And it was very primitive at the time. They just basically sectioned them, put them down on photographic paper, and looked at where the radiation exposed the paper, and actually gave a lot of information about where the radioactivity was and the particles. Another reason why I know that is because the Guam fallout thing has been just so totally interesting. I'm reading all these crazy papers about what stuff that they did back then. It's just,
I think, is that possible to do on a millimeter scale?
Yeah, the particles they were looking at were very small, so very fine grain photographic film would probably, and especially today, that was in the 50s that they were doing it. Today, the film grain size is very small.
Unlike the nuclear stuff, the lake, the atmosphere, the fish, everything has been monitored in those years. So you know exactly when it happens.
Yeah, so you have actual fish like whole fish measurements, right? They're just basically just blended it up. And, yeah. So you have you're in a unique spot for recent fallout. Now we have the Fukushima signal, which is swirling around in the North Pacific, and it's actually already been used. Strontium or cesium-134, which is, has a 2.6 year half life. So the only source of 134 is from Fukushima today. They've actually used it as a tracer for bluefin tuna that are typically born and start their first year of life off Japan, and then they migrate over off to off California and are caught. And they found very, very small quantities that were ahead of the natural circulation pattern. So it's shown that the fish had swum, you know, less than 2 years and made their way to the coast of California. So they brought the cesium signal with them. So interesting tracers from crazy things that people do.
Yeah.
Yeah, if there are no more questions, I think we should thank Alan once again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.